I'm Chris from the dominKnow team, and welcome to Flow. Flow helps you create great learning content for use no matter where your learners are, no matter what device they're using. That could be a course in your LMS, or a job aid or a knowledge portal outside your LMS. Flow gives you this power because it's a true responsive authoring tool. And because of that, the experience of working in Flow is different than working in traditional e-learning tools. So what does that mean? Well, in a traditional tool like PowerPoint or our own Claro, you make content that fits into a box because the slider page has a fixed width and a fixed height. And everything you add has a specific size and location within that box. No matter what screen size you view it on, the content will always keep its box shape, and things will always be in the same location. It's just bigger or smaller to view. That shrinking nature is very different than a truly responsive web page. A responsive web page is designed to change based on the width of the screen it's being viewed on. That change is more than just being bigger or smaller. Individual content on a page can change size and change location. In fact, the page can have different layouts altogether, say, a horizontal arrangement on a wide screen and a vertical arrangement on a narrower screen in portrait. In order to change like that, the page is structured differently. And understanding that difference lets you unlock the power of responsive design and the power of Flow. There are two really good metaphors to help you understand how a Flow page is structured and how it can change at different screen widths. The first metaphor is the Russian nesting doll, the idea that things are contained within larger things, contained within larger things. The second metaphor is this type of tile puzzle. The tiles are all in the same layer and move around each other into the empty space. Let's look at how each of these tie into a Flow page. Here's that sample page again. From a Flow page perspective, the text and image are all content. Content is the smallest of the Russian nesting dolls. Content is contained in an element. That's the second doll. So on our sample page, we had four pieces of content, and we also have four elements. Elements are contained within groups. You can have more than one element in a group. On our sample page, the image element and the text element below it are in the same group. This means they'll behave together as the page changes. Groups are contained within rows. You can have more than one group in a row. On our sample page, you can see the two main body content groups are in the same row. Rows are grouped into sections, and you can have more than one row in a section. So on our sample page, both rows are in one section. And lastly, sections are contained within the largest nesting doll, the page. And pages can have as many sections as you want because they're practically endless. In Flow content, the container levels, those Russian nesting dolls, control how content behaves. And you also have different control options over the levels. We'll look at that in a minute. Next, let's look at the second metaphor, the tile puzzle. In this type of puzzle, all the tiles are in the same level. They're all on rails and can move around each other only by moving into empty or available space. So how does this apply to Flow? Here's our sample page. Think of the various containers on the page as the tiles in the puzzle. They're all in the same layer, like they're all connected by rails. A Flow page has gravity. Things on the page will move up if there's space available at the same container level, as well as move left if there's space available at the same container level. How does this work? Well, we've already seen how the image element and the text element are in the same group. If we remove the image, the gravity of the page will pull the text element up into the available space above it. Containers always move up or left if space is available, and they move down and to the right if something new is added. And it's the gravity on the page and this idea of the tile puzzle, where everything's on rails and can only move into empty or available space, that are the engine of how Flow content can change based on screen width. Let's take a look at these two metaphors in Flow. Here's a version of our sample page. When I select an element on the page, you see the container structure in the breadcrumb list above the stage. There's the element that contains the image. There's the group, which contains the image element plus the text element below it. There's the row, which contains two groups. There's the section, which contains two rows. And there's the page, which contains the section. If I switch the tab on the left to view the page structure, you can see all these container levels as well. There's the image, there's the group it's in, there's the row it's in, and there's the section. And here's the gravity at work. If I select the image and hide it, you can see that the text element below it automatically moves into the now available space. Unhide the image, and the text is back down below it. When you combine the idea of the nesting dolls with the tile puzzle and gravity metaphor, a flow page can really do some dramatic things. Right now, the two groups in the bottom row are beside each other, arranged horizontally. But if I go down to the extra small breakpoint, the container levels and the gravity work together to push the group on the right down below the group on the left, so the two groups are now arranged vertically. What's really important to remember is that in Flow, you're making one page designed to change its behavior based on the width of the browser. You're not making multiple pages. We describe this as true responsive. Flow pages may have a different structure than PowerPoint or traditional e-learning tools, but we've still tried to make authoring as uncomplicated as possible. Getting started is easy. Pick a section, add some content. If we go to the Home tab and select the Page button, you can see what I mean. On the New Page panel, you can choose from Starters, Layouts, or Templates. Starters are template pages made for the course you're working in. Our sample courses all have starter pages. Layouts are basic sections you can work with. Think of them like adding a new page in PowerPoint. And templates are pre-designed sections with more visual variety and interactivity. There are dozens of templates available, so spend some time getting familiar with them. For now, let's start with a blank layout, one with a header and three columns of content. I can set the response behavior at the small and extra small breakpoints. Let's set the body content to rotate at just the extra small breakpoint range. There's the layout, added as a page. Because it's a layout, the header element is expecting text. Now I can quickly add content of any sort to the three body elements. Besides the links and the placeholders, you can add any type of content from the Insert tab, including our interactive and responsive components. If I select the breakpoint icons above the stage, the body content switches to vertical at the extra small breakpoint range, just like we set it. To change that, select the section in the breadcrumb list and use this drop-down to choose a different behavior. The starters, layouts, and templates make it easy to get started, and you can always add more to the same page. Use the Add Layout button to add another starter, layout, or template. Or use the Build Layout button to create your own custom sections, row by row. It's easy to make almost any layout you can imagine. Once you've started, you can go so much further. The selection control bar gives you design control over each Russian nesting doll level, so you can add backgrounds, set alignment, spacing, and more. You can hide content at different breakpoints to really customize the user experience for different screen widths. Not to mention all the action options available for you to create your own custom interactivity. You can go way beyond the basics, and that's where the fun and creativity comes in. As you're learning, don't forget the Help tab is always available. You can work through the Flow training guide or search the Flow knowledge base, both made in Flow, or contact our support team at any time. So, getting started in Flow is easy, but it is different than working in PowerPoint or a traditional e-learning tool. Because of that difference, Flow will help you make great learning content for use no matter where your learners are, no matter what device they use. Whether that's a course in your LMS or a knowledge base or job aid outside your LMS. That's the power of content that is truly responsive.